Hi, I'm Mohamed Sidibay. Welcome to the second episode of Raise Your Hand Live, a monthly talk show featuring changemakers from across the globe who all believe education is a key to building a better and more equal future for all. That means protecting and investing in the education of refugees, internally displaced, and stateless children and youth, the vast majority of which live in developing countries. To tell us more about why that matters for youth, here are activist and journalist Maryam and Naval Rehman, founders of The World with MNR.
Refugee youth are powerful and have the ability to create incredible changes in their communities and shape their futures when given the resources and opportunities to do so. One of the best ways we can ensure that this happens is through quality education access for all refugees, because this will give them the tools that they need to be able to make their visions come to life. Some of the best examples of initiatives by refugees that we've seen include Startup Zaatari, Team Refugees at the Olympics, and also all the other youth-led ventures found in Azra Camp in Jordan. However, with the COVID-19 pandemic, many existing inequalities across a variety of issues have been exacerbated, and COVID-19 has also threatened the progress that has been made with education over the years. This has grave risks for children around the world, but especially refugee youth, and unless they're able to go back to school and have quality education access, progress will not be made and they'll be prevented from transforming their communities and shaping their futures. This is why we raise our hands for GPE, to protect the progress that has been made to date and also work hand in hand with governments and donors to invest in sustainable solutions. Solutions that include refugees in national education systems and solutions that harness the power and potential of refugees in shaping their own future.
We are all too familiar with the power of education in creating upward mobility, strengthening democracies, and reviving economies. To achieve our goal of perpetual peace, we need to ensure that refugees and displaced children and youth don't miss out on a quality education. Let's welcome our two distinguished guests for today, Filippo Grandi, United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, and Karina Gould, the Canadian Minister of International Development. Commissioner Grandi and Minister Gould, welcome, and thank you both for joining in this important conversation. According to the most recent estimate, of the 80 million forcibly displaced people worldwide, up to 34 million are under 18. Refugees are five times less likely to attend school than other children in their host countries. If we don't provide education for displaced children, we risk depriving an entire generation of their best chance to reach their full potential. The 2018 Global Compact on Refugees set an ambitious goal that governments should be positioned to include refugee children and youth in national education systems within three months of displacement. With partners like UNHCR and Canada, GPU support countries to include refugee children and youth into national education systems, providing financial, technical, and policy support for countries to invest in sustainable and lasting reforms. The Raise Your Hand financing campaign is a chance for world leaders to step up and commit to support government's commitments to equality and inclusion. First question for Filippo. Many governments do or are willing to include refugees in national education systems. What factors are instrumental in determining the inclusion of refugees into a national education system as opposed to separate systems?
Thanks, Mohamed, and thanks for having me here. This is a crucial question. You know, I've worked many years with refugees and displaced people. Traditionally, many years ago, the approach was to create for these people separate structures, refugee camps, refugee schools, refugee health centers. And we've realized that especially with long conflict that never get resolved, perpetuating this refugee crisis, this was not a sustainable approach. And that it would be better if refugees, displaced people, and other people with whom my organization works were included in national system. In the case of education, in national education system. So in other words, if refugees in countries where they are, and remember, you said it yourself, 90% of those 80 million people displaced and refugees are in poor countries or middle-income countries, it would be better if they were included in national education systems, sharing the schools, the resources of the children in their host communities. What are the main challenges that this creates? One is resources, because of course, poor countries having to absorb in their system, even for only a period of time, large student population, they need more resources. And then, of course, there are sometimes political resistances that also have to be addressed. So we're really asking GPE, we're asking this campaign, which is most welcome, to help us advocate for these two things. One, inclusion of refugee children, of displaced children in their national education structures, and two, mobilization of resources, of international resources, to help those countries who do the right thing and include children in their systems. And by the way, last point, very important. When we talk about mobilizing resources, it's not just for the refugees. It's also for the host communities. Those children will share the same schools, the same teachers, the same instruments to learn, the same supplies and equipment. So it is important that those resources are equitably divided between refugees and host communities to create even more cohesion and therefore more sustainability in the education of those that are forcibly on the move.
As someone who was a child soldier in my home country, Sierra Leone, I do understand and see the importance of having resources, because resources really is a huge part into the absorption of refugee populations into national systems, because without resources, like you said, some of these systems will collapse and they will not be able to continue to support or provide education, not just for refugee children, but for their own citizens as well. Karina, how are G7 countries and Canada specifically working to support countries deliver on the Global Compact on refugees?
Well, thanks, Mohamed, for the question. And thank you for hosting this conversation today. I think it's really important to talk about education for refugees and displaced children and youth and people right around the world. Because one of the things that we launched in Canada just a couple of weeks ago was the Together for Learning campaign, which really is about ensuring that all children, all youth who are forcibly displaced have access to education. And part of that Together for Learning campaign is having a global refugee education council with refugee voices from around the world talking about education and why it matters and why it's important. And for me, those voices really spur us as Canada and as a G7 country to do this work. And maybe I'll just build off of Filippo's last point, because I think, as he said, it's not just about supporting refugee children, it's also about making sure that host communities have the resources that they need so that you can provide quality education for everyone and also build bridges and human connection between displaced people and host communities so that you don't have an othering, so that they're not separated ostracized and put off to the side or seen as a threat. One of the things that's important is it's about building trust and about ensuring that there's opportunity for everyone. And so one of the things that Canada has been doing over the past number of years, which I think has been quite successful, is doing that joint investment in supports for refugees as well as host communities. And we've done this in response to the Syrian refugee crisis in communities in Lebanon and in Jordan. We're doing this right now with regards to the Venezuelan migrant crisis in neighboring countries like Colombia and Peru and Ecuador, and as well in the Rohingya crisis, supporting both the Rohingya refugees as well as host communities in Bangladesh in Cox's Bazar. And so, you know, we still have a lot of work to do to make sure that we're doing this integration, but Canada is pushing for this kind of holistic response to make sure that we're addressing the very real needs of individual refugees, as well as supporting the community that is hosting them. And this is also about building off of the humanitarian development peace nexus, recognizing that humanitarian work can't just be a point in time. We also need to do that broader development work. And so these are some of the things that Canada is pushing, as well as our G7 partners.
I think, you know, I mean, as someone who have very close ties to Canada, I remember, you know, growing up in Sierra Leone right after the war, and in the most difficult time in my life, when a group of fifth graders, Canadian fifth graders, raised money in their schools by selling cookies and different things to ensure that I was able to have uniforms and shoes to be able to go to school. And I think if young children can do that, it's always a testament of the Canadian will to ensure that children everywhere have access to equal education. Education cannot be handed out at a distribution center. It has to be planned, coordinated, budgeted, implemented, monitored, and certified for transferability. A quality education needs to take into account the social and emotional issues that affect learning, the gender biases, the linguistic challenges, the missed years of education, and much more. 2020 counts as a global crisis context, one during which COVID-19 spurred us to work better together, to forge alliances across sectors, and to harness the expertise of many. It has also brought us together with a common resolve to protect our hard-earned gains in education, including protecting education financing. Filippo, how have refugees been affected by the pandemic? And what innovative and promising solutions have been developed in response to COVID that can improve learning opportunities for refugee populations in the long term?
I was thinking, Mohamed, while you were speaking, I remember this is really interesting. I think it was 28 years ago, mm-hmm. I was in a remote county of Liberia, bringing help to Sierra Leonean refugees stranded. I think you know those areas, Bahoun County, stranded in the most remote areas. Really, the difficulty of giving them food and the basics in this. I think that we have made a lot of progress since then in considering, for example, education as vital as food and shelter. And I think we need to keep everybody on that page of the emergency nature of education needs for people on the move. Because in those days, we really didn't even think about that or didn't even talk about that. Maybe the refugees thought about it, but we didn't talk about that. It was not a priority. Now, how COVID has impacted all this, of course, is risky, is dangerous. COVID has had a health impact on the population on the move, like on everybody else. And now the challenge is, of course, including them in vaccination campaigns. Then it has had what I would call a very severe economic impact, because these are communities that prosper, if I can use this word, or live, rather, off the type of jobs that disappear very quickly in lockdowns. Then it has had a protection impact, because with borders closed, it is more difficult for people that flee out of war or persecution to seek safety. But a fourth and equally important impact has been in the education sector. Because, and this is all interlinked, you know, impoverished families told me in Lebanon just very recently that they couldn't afford anymore sending their children to school because they had to have their children work. And this is particularly harsh on refugee girls. I've said it already several times that we've conducted a study with the Malala Foundation indicating that when all schools will reopen after lockdowns, it is very likely that up to half of the refugee girls that used to go to school will not go back to schools. Many, unfortunately, will have been married off for economic reasons into early marriages that are, you know, equal to exploitation and even worse forms of exploitation and abusive behaviors. So really, we're very worried about that. What to do? Well, first of all, Again, it's a matter of resources. For countries that are severely impacted by the COVID pandemic, especially economic, the rescue packages that are being designed by international institutions will have to include a consideration of these countries hosting large numbers of refugees and having to bring them back to school. Meanwhile, there's many things that we can do and are already doing. For example, we've stepped up cash distributions to refugees because this is the best way to bridge the gap between now when they don't have employment and when things will start being more normal again. And then creative, last point, creative approaches. More distance learning, for example, which requires technology. We do it with the private sector in Africa, for example, you know, connecting schools that are remote. Now many more schools have become remote because of circumstances, even those that are not geographically remote. So distance learning has acquired a big space. We're working with UNICEF and others to intensify these programs, resource them well during this difficult period.
It really is a difficult period for everyone. And I think everyone around the world is suffering due to COVID-19, from the West to the most developed countries in the world to the least developed countries in the world. And what makes COVID-19 so much more for refugees is that it's compounded suffering. No one goes to a refugee camp because they want to live there forever. You know, like the whole notion of refugees is supposed to be, there's some temporality aspect to it, not so much so for someone to spend their entire childhood, their entire adulthood at refugee camps, but, you know, based on decisions that are outside externalities that they cannot do anything about. And we, as a society, we do have a responsibility to make sure that these children should not just look into short-term financing, but long-term financing into preparing refugees from going back into society. Karina, as we continue to focus on our COVID responses, what has and can the international community do to make sure that we don't see a backslide in gains made on global education, particularly for refugees and girls?
So maybe I can just start by saying thank you, Mohamed, for sharing that story of when you were in grade 5 here in Canada, because I think it really humanizes and brings down to people in their hearts why this is important, because it's not about, you know, I mean, it's about millions of people, but it's also about one person, right? And the opportunity and the hope that that provides and enables. And I have to say that I was really fighting back tears when you were talking about it, because it made me really proud. And also just to hear that, I think is really, really important. In terms of what the global community can do, it's funding education. It's funding ministries of education. It's funding those innovative mechanisms and tools to ensure that all these displaced children have access to an education. You know, you talked about some people spending their entire childhood or adult lives in a refugee camp. I mean, when we think that, you know, the average stay in a refugee camp now is 17 years. 17 years. I mean, if 12 of those are supposed to be spent in formal education, right? That, you know, that is a big chunk of somebody's life. And as you said, nobody has decided that that's where they want to be, right? They're there because they need to be there. And, you know, this is why for us as donor governments, making sure that our COVID response is holistic, and actually Canada's has been, in that, you know, we made sure that we have a very robust response to the health emergency that we have right now, but recognizing that this emergency is broader than that. And, you know, children being out of school is a huge potential loss for us right now, but also for the future. And I think that education right now resonates with people in a way that it might not have before, because I can at least say here in Canada, you know, for the first time, parents understood what it meant to not have their children in school. And, you know, we made a relatively small announcement early on in the pandemic for $7.5 million to support distance education, mostly in African countries. But it got, you know, front page coverage in Canada because people resonated with it. They understood what it was to have their children out of school in a way that they might not have. And that digital divide, right? I think that's another really important one. Is I had this wonderful conversation with a teacher in Dadaab refugee camp, who was talking about the fact that it's one thing to say distance education. It's one thing to say, oh, we can do it over technology. But whether that's a cell phone, whether that's a laptop, whether that's a radio, some of his students don't have access to any of those technologies. And so we need to be thinking about how do you A, connect people to make sure that they can stay connected and continue with their education. But then also think about what does that mean in different contexts? And so Canada is very proud to have supported initiatives like Education Cannot Wait or GPE, which very quickly released $500 million at the outset of the pandemic to make sure that access to education could continue. Also, programs like or groups like War Child Canada, which is doing really interesting radio learning in places like Democratic Republic of Congo or Code Canada and other NGOs. But it's also about thinking, okay, so how do we ensure continuity of education? But then how do we also get kids back into school? And the things that Filippo was talking about at the beginning of children who are out of school because of the pandemic, but are now working, or who have been forced into an early marriage, or because of teen pregnancy. There are a lot of countries around the world where if you are pregnant, you're no longer allowed to return to school. And so thinking about all of those barriers that exist for young people, how do we ensure that they can not only carry on with their studies at this moment of disruption, but they also go back into them? Because this is about supporting the next generation of leaders and ensuring that they can get to school, because it matters for all of us.
It truly does matter, because I think the days, part of one of the greatest thing about the 21st century is this globalization, how we're all connected. And because we're all connected, we also have to be aware that things that happen in other parts of the world could have either a positive or negative impact on countries that used to think they were too far away. It really is. It's sad for a child or for parents to get to make the decision. Are they going to send their child to school, or are they going to starve? You know, like, how are they going to split the money, pay school fees or get materials for school, or feed the family? And I think it's a choice that no one should ever have to make, especially when it comes to education, because to really achieve the world that we all envisioned, education is at the center, as at the center of this. As you both know, GPE is asking world leaders and supporters to raise their hands to fund education through GPE, because every change starts with a powerful act, which can be as simple as raising your hand in the classroom. Will each of you take this opportunity to tell us why you raise your hand for GPE?
We somehow associate refugees, displaced people, with people on the move, people on the run. You know it, Mohammed, you run from conflict, you run from torture, you run from persecution. The paradox is that people on the run may be the people left behind. And you know the motto of the development goals: no one should be left behind. So what makes me raise my hand is that education is perhaps the most powerful tool not to leave anybody behind, including those people on the run that risk so much this exclusion from the future of humanity. And you know, it is not just because education, clearly, as we all know, and we have said it, provides knowledge, provides, equips people for life, helps them find job and have a meaningful life in society, but also because, and I've seen it so much, I've seen it with refugees from very protracted situations like the Palestinians, the Afghans, the Somalis. They always cling to education as hope for the future. This gives them dignity. This gives them a prospect of going towards the light and not the darkness. It is really a life-changing experience, even more spiritually than just materially. So this is why education is so important. And this is why, and proud to do it next to the Canadian Minister of Development. Canada has been such a formidable partner to UNHCR in every refugee situation. So I'm very proud to raise my hands here.
Well, Filippo said it so well. And when I was thinking about this, I was thinking about the first conversation that I had with a couple of the members of my Refugee Education Council when we launched the Together for Learning campaign. And I asked them why education mattered. And they said, because education is more than knowledge. It represents hope. It represents a safe place. And in some ways, it represents a solve and a sanctuary against what they're trying to get away from. And for me, I think that's what is so important. It's offering that safe space, offering that opportunity to dream and to hope for what growth and the future and the possibility of the future represents. It also, one of the things that I loved in one of the conversations that I had recently was it's about taking the power back. It's about taking some form of control over the situation in which you find yourself and saying, I can learn, I can do these things, I am capable, I am able to make those decisions for myself and for my future. And so for me, it's about providing that to all those little girls and little boys and young women and young men out there who should be able and have the right actually to access that. We, as Filippo said, we've gotten pretty good at making sure people have access to food and shelter, the bare minimum, the basics. But we need to nourish their spirit as well and allow for that growth to take place. And so I'm so proud that Canada is helping to lead in this effort and to work with partners like UNHCR, GPE, ECW, and so many others, because we have an obligation to those people who have taken the courageous step and the brave step to find safety and to make sure that we're supporting them in their growth and what they can offer us. Right? Like that's the other thing. It's not just about, it's about really recognizing that, you know, these are humans and people who have so much to offer the world. And so let's not hold them back, right? Let's see what they're capable of and support them in that. So that's why I'm raising my hand for refugee education.
I think you said like taking the power back. It really is important for people to take back their power. And one of the ways, the sure way we know of people, children, boys and girls, being able to do this is through education. I know that the agency, my education has given me, looking at the ability to dream. I can now dream of things that I never thought was possible. Coming from a war-torn country, but yet here I am with world-class education and soon to be a lawyer. And so this just goes back and show like the power of taking power and having agency and dreaming and having people with resources to be able to support these children all over the world. We are simultaneously facing the greatest education emergency in living memory and a massive economic crisis. What we've heard today should remind us, it is more important than ever that aid to education is channeled to where it is most needed and to where it would have the greatest impact on improving the lives of the world's most marginalized girls and boys. If fully funded with at least $5 billion, GPU will do just that. Thank you each and every one of you for joining me in this conversation and for getting to hear the wonderful things that you are doing to ensure that children everywhere are protected and they have the opportunity to receive the best quality.